But another story on Alan's watches was about 2.5 years ago, Alan. We were out at the Wasatch Front Regional Council, and I know you're going to remember this, because I came in with my executive director, and Alan was sitting here on my left, and I got a chair over here on the right, and I made the big mistake of putting my executive director right next to Alan. And 2 months later, she was working for Envision Utah. But I know that was a good move for Christy, and I know she's really happy there, and I have another executive director that works for me, and we're still plugging along. We don't do a whole lot of projects in terms of number of projects per year. We only do one or two. We're a really small organization, and we focus on green infrastructure. So my background's a little unusual. A lot of you folks here in this room have been driving by old family property in Western Summit County at Kimball's Junction for years. Dad bought a 1,200-acre ranch in 1957 at Kimball's Junction, and now a lot of that has gone into the Swanner Nature Preserve and Eco Center, which was just gifted to Utah State University about 6 weeks ago. Are people generally aware of that? Yes. Biggest gift that USU's ever received, $33 million. And we started that project 20 years ago. Actually, back in the 60s, I was working on Dad's cattle ranch, and that's part of my background, is having that ranching experience. In the 70s, I worked for the Division of Wildlife Resources as a fisheries and a wildlife ecologist. And so that's a bit of my background also. And like Alan, my father graduated from Stanford with an MBA. And so I have a bit of a business background also. And as you're driving through Western Summit County and Kimball's Junction, you're actually going past several hundred dwelling units that we have built over the years. And we're currently involved in an 880,000 square foot commercial development called New Park that some of you may have actually been shopping at. So I have this real estate development background also, and I bring all those tools combined with my degree in landscape architecture to communities that are interested in really focusing in almost laser-like on open space or green infrastructure. So typically I get asked to come into a community that for whatever reason there's some dissatisfaction normally with the pattern of development, and people are not necessarily quibbling with the fact that a real estate developer is doing something, it's how they're doing it. So I have a slightly different approach than the presenters that you've seen this morning, and let's just get into it. I'm a little nonprofit, and I'm going to get this right if I can. What is open space and why do we care about it? Let's see if I got this. Oh, that's not the world's smallest mouse. That's the actual thing that picks up this. I got it, Claudia. I finally figured out what it is. What does growth look like? This is a little animated piece that's not working this morning, so we can skip over that. Just a photograph of Midway, which is in Wasatch County. And this is a place that's experiencing so much growth that the land use planners are just trying to overlay the approved subdivisions, which is a little tough to see with the room the way that it's lit. The growth is happening faster than they can literally lay out the subdivisions in their community. So we plan for continued growth, plan to encourage the desired development patterns. And as I said, this ground has been covered quite a bit this morning. But one of the human rights that isn't officially guaranteed in this country is an agreement that the places you grew up caring about will be there for you when you're ready to start your own family. And for me, having open space preserved at the beginning of a community's development, so that as the tide of development goes through a community, when the population arrives, and as Alan said, when the commercial finally shows up, you've got the open space and you're not clamoring to try and go get it. So what I found through my research is that in most communities, there's no clarity in terms of what is the definition of open space. And I'll make that real obvious in the next couple of slides. Typically, what we're trying to do is find the gap. When we review communities' general plan ordinances, we'll see all this great language about how we want to preserve the environment, natural resources, provide commerce for our citizens, so on and so forth. But then you get into the subdivision regulations, and you find that there is no provision to do any of those kinds of sort of aesthetical things in your community. What you're generating is road right-of-ways and building lots. And you're not really adhering to what's going on in the general plan language. So we're trying to fill those gaps. We use a systems thinking rule, and what we're saying there is, open space should be a system. It should be a gray, it should be similar to the gray infrastructure you have in your community, only it's a green infrastructure. First things first, the land. What we've learned in our processes and using our methodologies, that if you can tackle the land-based issues first and then deal with your perceptions of what real estate development are, you're much better off doing it in that sort of sequence. So I differ a little bit from Envision Utah in that regard. And as Alan and Brian have said, it's all a local effort. And then we specialize in policy. This is something that we do. We get down and write the actual policies. So we encourage implementation, but we take it a step further and actually write those policies. So I'm going to focus on this chart just a little bit so we can sort of speed through this presentation. So years ago, 10, 12 years ago, when I was wondering about what it is in America that makes up our open space and why we have such a difficult time grappling with it, I started doing research and I came up with this acronym. So if I went around this room and had everybody raise their hand and say, what's your definition of open space, your definition, I could drop everyone's definition into one of these four categories. Not the D ones so much, because those are easements and right-of-ways and things that the city engineer would know, but the general public wouldn't. But I can tell you that the cultural, ecological, agricultural, or recreational open space types are found in all communities. And you'll find that various people have various interests to a certain extent in one of these or more. And that's what makes up the community's definition of open space. So this is a template that we created to just make sure people understand what we're talking about. Everybody's matrix will be different. In Western Summit County, where my family had their ranching operation, the agricultural list used to go down onto the floor and out here. Well, now in Western Summit County, there's very little ag left, but it's become a recreational mecca. So the recreational uses in Western Summit County fall down on the floor, and that's their big list. So every community is a little bit different, and like others have mentioned before, our job is to go in and find out what your values for these kinds of open spaces are. We don't come in with a predetermined idea of what open space is, but we want to try and find out if you're interested in these list of things, viewpoints, view sheds, outdoor classrooms, some of these more aesthetically oriented or cultural or historical types of open spaces. The ecological ones, slope, water quality, a lot of these types are actually sitting up on the walls in the back of the room. But we want to take the opportunity to have a workshop format where you get to tell us which ones of these and where are you most interested in when it comes to perhaps saving them from real estate development. So, Alan, this is actually Steve Ostema down in the Jordan River Parkway. He's taking a walk underneath these large power lines that abound the central drainage area of the Jordan River. And I just use this category to make sure that we don't lose something like this. This is a corridor that'll never have a structure in it, and it's a great place for connectivity to hook things up. So we want to find those, but it's pretty boring for the public to deal with these things, so we don't put them in our workshops. And in agricultural, of course, again, just looking for the types of spaces and their locations, whether they're based on soils or they're based on, you know, other factors, water rights, what have you. Where are the agricultural areas in a community and which ones do we want to try and save? And then recreational types of open spaces are probably more familiar to people in this audience than any other because it's an easy one to make the connection with. So, as I said, first things first, what we try and do is go through a process where we identify these with the community, sort of run it through the sieve of the CEDAR, and then we come up with different types of maps. So our mapping process is quite a bit different than Envision Utah. We're primarily focused on open space.